Thank you. reciting the Apostles' Creed together. Congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Job 2, 1 through 10.
Job 2, 1 through 10. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where have you come?" Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." And the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth? A blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still holds fast his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without reason." Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Skin for skin, all that a man has, he will give for his life. Stretch out your hand and touch his bone and flesh, and he will curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, he is in your hand. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took a piece of broken pottery with which to scrape himself while he sat in the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God? Shall we not receive evil?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Then our second reading is from 2 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 7 through 10. Familiar portion. To us, things that a lot of us have read over and over again as Paul writes them to the Corinthian church. Second Corinthians 12, 7 through 10. "So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. And he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong." So we go to the Lord in prayer for our congregational prayer. Our Lord and God, we come to you in Jesus' name. We come to you with the help of you, Holy Spirit, guiding our prayers. We ask that you would translate them into ways that, Lord, are acceptable to the Father, and that, Lord, truly speak of the desires of our heart as we preach and pray to you this morning. Our Father and God, we first of all lift up those who are shut in, who, Lord, need your daily provision just to get through perhaps the morning or the afternoon or the evening or through a night's sleep. We ask, Lord, for Eve Thomas, that you would provide for her. We know she has new dentures in this last month or so. We pray that they don't have to be adjusted, that she can chew her food well with them. We pray that this simple, practical benefit to her is making life better for her there at Bellhaven. We pray, Father, for Manny Avalos, Mother Joseph, for Gloria Coleman, and for George McLaren, especially, Lord, in their situations. We especially pray for Rhoda, who's been declining a bit with her Parkinson's. We pray, Lord, for your healing touch to her, that she would know your strength. We pray the doctors would know how to prescribe medication for her that will not make things worse and at least sicken her and cause some problems as she takes that medicine. We pray that she can have it adjusted or have something different that will do her much more good. We pray, Father, for George, and so as we see him here, we thank you, Lord, that he is up to coming and is able to be with us. May he know we love him and welcome him into our midst. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that he would benefit from the sermon today and from the worship of you, our God. We pray for Bob and Barbara Koch, who joins us on Saturdays from the Men's Reformed Fellowship. We pray for him as he goes through treatments for cancer in the lung. We pray that he is healing and that things are going well for him. We pray for Barbara that she would be fully recovered from the heart surgery that she went through in past months. We ask for a Justin today who's not with us, but Lord, you would be with him. He's having foot problems, and we pray, Lord, for healing there. We know that he is sort of waiting to have some medical treatment, perhaps even surgery on his feet. And so we pray, Lord, that you would provide for him and make it possible for him to have relief from these bone spurs that he has and bring healing to him. We continue to pray for Pat Caraboli, Lord, from her healing from her depression. We pray that you would guide and direct her to your word, that she would find strength in it, that she would actually be healed by your spirit from her depression. We pray that also, Lord, you would work your grace in her heart and bring her to salvation. We pray for Nancy Yates. We're glad to see her today. We know that she's having this knee problem. We pray you would touch her and bring healing to her, help the therapy that she's having to strengthen her and make her completely better. Glad to see Joe with her too, and we pray for his health issues, Lord, that you would guide him through them, and we pray that through the help of the doctors, that, Lord, you would find things that would be helpful to him in this time. Lord, we pray for Chuck Hamill Sr., and we do pray for him in these days when he has gotten a terminal diagnosis. We pray that you would comfort and sustain him by your word, through your spirit, strengthen Pauline, his wife. We pray, Lord, for your grace, as the Apostle Paul said, to be a strength and weakness for him this day. And we pray for Pastor Rich as he goes on vacation this week for the month of August. We pray that it would be a time of relaxation, a time of being able to do some things that are not easy for him to get done. We pray that he would be able to put together an agenda to be able to do all those things during this month. We pray that he might even have some time for relaxation. Perhaps he and his father can take a trip somewhere, maybe even have a picnic or an outing, Lord, to get out and enjoy the summer activities and summer weather. We pray, most of all, Lord, for your blessing on today's message and today's service to us. We pray that we are listening to your word, and that, Lord, wherever our statuses right now in our relationship with you, we would commit ourselves fully to your care and trust you, Lord, for every crook in the lock and every situation that you bring into our lives, that we might see, Lord, how they all work together for good through us in the Lord and love God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before our sermon, we'll sing Day by Day and With Each Passing Moment, 676. Shall we stand?
Saying to us, and how things, as I was reading from about Paul and
2 Corinthians 12. We'll read about Job and Job 2. And they all come together to show us that we're going to have those ups and downs in our lives. And we need them to know it's not very hard to take the ups in your life, but it is pretty hard to take the downs in your life. And that's what the preacher is trying to get to today for us. So we're reading verses 13 to 18 from the 7th chapter. Consider the work of God. Who can make straight what he has made crooked? In the day of prosperity, be joyful, and in the day of adversity, consider. God has made the one as well as the other, so that man may not find out anything that will be after him. In my vain life, I have seen everything. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man who prolongs his life in his evil doing. Be not overly righteous, and do not make yourself too wise. Why should you destroy yourself? Be not overly wicked, neither be a fool. Why should you die before your time? It is good that you should take hold of this, and from that withhold not your hand, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. To start off today, I have to make a confession, and it's not about some sin in my life, so please don't think, discipline in our church. It's the fact that as I came to this text, and as I looked at various commentators and all, they all related this text, especially in verse 13, to the great Puritan Thomas Boston, who wrote probably the most famous sermon on this text called The Crook and the Lot. I don't know if you ever read that book, but this is my confession. Until I prepared this sermon, I had not read anything by Thomas Boston, except maybe quotes. We'll hear a couple in the sermon this morning. So, of course, I looked for a cheap way to get the book, because it's in paperback. And I got a copy and I read it not long after I finished this sermon. So I can say at least I've read one book by Thomas Boston. And it's worth reading, even though it's written in the 1600s, and we all know the English in the 1600s isn't the English of today. So you got to bear with the way he says things, the words he uses, and his grammar and so forth. But it's worth it to read that book. Now, as I said, the sermon's based on the command and question that we have in Ecclesiastes 7:13. Consider what God has done, who can straighten what he has made crooked? And in this sermon, dealing with God's sovereignty, Pastor Boston wisely writes, in that train of course of events, some fallout cross to us and against the grain. These make the crook in our lot. While we are here, there will be cross events, as well as agreeable ones, in our lot and condition. Sometimes things are softly and agreeably gliding on. But by and by, there is some incident which alters that course and grates us and pains us. Everybody's lot in this world has some crook in it. There is no perfection here. No lot out of heaven without a crook. And so we come to famous text. Please once, but I think more than one Puritan preached on this text over their time. But in the beginning here at this verse, our sermon passage reminds us how our sovereign God works. If there is some doctrine that we should be reminded about constantly, I think Ecclesiastes 7:13 carefully points out that to us. How many times during the course of our lives Do we deny God's sovereignty in our lives by questioning what he decrees in our day-to-day living? Let me ask, did you ever get mad over some petty or insignificant thing that happens to you? Like maybe things piling on you, four or five things in a row, and you're just like, that's the last straw. I can't take this anymore. Why is everything against me? Or it's just a simple thing, like you lose your car keys, and you're all supposed to be getting off to work, and you can't find them. You're looking all over the house, and you get frustrated. And you say, Lord, why me? Why today? I got so much to do at work. Maybe you get bent out of shape because, just like last night, the Phillies blew the lead and lost a game. It's not uncommon for them. They go up 4-1 and they lose 7-6. So there's all sorts of things we can grumble about. I think I've made that point. But have we questioned why God allowed things to happen to us? Do we think about it that way? Do we think that there's some little demon walking around our house doing things against us? Is that how we think about it? Are we always attributing it to Satan and saying, well, it's Satan. He's doing this, he's doing that. And I'm not saying he doesn't. We see what happens to Job, not at all. But some of these things are simply God's way of slowing us down and saying, take it easy. I'm in control. Let me be God over your life. So all sorts of providential things happen to us that cause us consternation and make us grumble and complain over God's crook in our lot. You know, in the life of Thomas Boston, he knew what he was doing when he wrote his book, Crook in the Lot. Let me tell you a little bit about him and his wife and family. He suffered from poor health all his life, though he never missed a Sunday preaching in the pulpit, and he was in the same church for 25 years. His wife suffered from chronic illness of the body, and it's also thought that she had problems mentally as well. But the greatest crick in their lot came through the death of their children. They lost 6 of the 10 babies born to his wife. So you think it's hard enough to lose one, you'll lose 6 of the 10. My friends, what do you do when trials come? Thomas Boston knew what trials were. He could write this book. The preacher knows what trials are. And so we're going to look at 2 points from this sermon. There will be crooks in our lot during our lives. We can guarantee that. I don't have to tell anybody that sitting here. We all know there are going to be things that we are not happy with that happen in our lives. And secondly, the preacher tells us to overcome the crooks in our lot, we must live in the fear of God. First of all, there will be crooks in our lives. Verses 13 and 14. But we'll look at verse 13 again. Consider what God has done. Who can straighten what he has made crooked? And we should be guarded about interpreting this verse, this statement. It's not an expression of fatalism that Solomon is observing. He's a good Calvinist. He believes in a sovereign God. And that's what he's expressing. God's sovereignty isn't a doctrine we just teach in church or Sunday school. It's the most practical teaching and belief that we are to live it out in our lives. And if your pastor or in past sermons or reading books and all you've gotten is the doctrine itself, and you haven't been taught how to live practically through that doctrine, something's been missing. We have to live what we believe. Faith is not just a concept up there. That's a doctrinal point that we talk about. It's something that impacts our lives. So, and by the way, I'm preaching to myself, not just to you. So if I sound like I'm just preaching at you, I'm standing in front of you. I'm there where that camera is, okay? Now the preacher says in this verse, consider, there in verse 13, consider the work of God. What does he mean by that? He intends that as believers in God, we live as though he is everything Scripture reveals him to be. Is God the God who created everything and orders all things? Yes, he is. Then we need to live that faith out in our lives by observing carefully and reflecting on what we observe of God's sovereignty every day of our lives. Whether things seem straight or crooked in our lot, we need to evaluate our situations always in terms of a sovereign God. Thomas Boston believed that if God made our lot crooked, then we need to see the crooked as God's work and know that it is vain to try to change it or work against it. He wrote, "What God sees meet to mar, we will not be able to mend." So something happens and it's beyond your control, and it's not a pleasant thing. I can tell you one thing from experience as well as reading God's Word. You can't change it. You have to accept it and let God be God and do what he plans to do through that group in your life. Ecclesiastes 1:15 says, "What is twisted cannot be straightened, and what is lacking cannot be counted." The wording in these opening words of the verse, in verse 13, are much like these words in Ecclesiastes 1:15. The thing is about Ecclesiastes 1:15, the preacher speaking there, remember, he speaks sometimes from this world under the sun, we'll talk about. And then he talks about events in heaven. So looking at things up as earthly is what he's talking about there in the first chapter. So that's the difference between what he talks about in the first chapter and what he talks about here in chapter 7. We've reached a halfway point in Ecclesiastes where I don't know if you remember my last sermon on this, but we've turned a corner, so to speak, in the book, and now he's going to be bringing God in more often. He's going to be answering certain questions for us that he's sort of hinted at and brought up through the first part of the book. So we get to this section here in chapter 7, and he's looking at things from God's perspective in some ways. Now, in Kola's question here, when he says who can make straight what he has made crooked, it's obvious no one is the answer to that. And Douglas Sean O'Donnell calls these first three verses here in chapter 7 that we're looking at, that Solomon makes it a Job moment. And Job is the godly example of what we should be responding to when we have quirks in our lives. That's why I read it from Job 2. What did he say when all went against him? And then God allowed Satan to take his health and hurt his body? What a tremendous testimony to the Lord. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble? We have to remember we cannot change what God has done unless and until God wants to change it. We're under the power of a sovereign and omnipotent ruler of the universe. We don't have the power to edit or alter God's plan for us as well. But this should not drive us from despair. Certainly, we all know that we have to pray. when we have negative things occur in our lives, we have to say, Lord, teach me. Teach me thy ways, as Psalm 25 talks about. We need to remember that we are Calvinists, that we believe in the sovereign God, and that He orders all things, even the things that do become very unpleasant for us. Joseph, remember, also had a lot of negative things in his life. First of all, his brothers hated him. Well, I'm not sure if his father and his mother loved him that much either when he was telling them, you're going to worship me, you're going to bow down to me, and so forth. But after everything worked out and they were all in Egypt, Joseph says this, God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done. Took almost 20 years for Joseph to see that realized. And I hope that our negative things don't take 20 years for God to bring about good out of them. But we have to remember sometimes that is the way God works. Now the preacher goes on to tell us not only what to believe and affirm, but how to live right. There's practicalness to this. When times are good, he says in verse 14, be happy. When times are bad, consider, God has made the one as well as the other. Therefore, a man cannot discover anything about his future. Once again, he has the word consider there, which means we're to put forth an effort to carefully observe and reflect on our situations. We aren't to go around, as I often do, and say, I don't like this, I can't stand it, I don't know what to do, I feel frustrated. You know, the computer broke down again on me. I don't want to call Comcast. I get so upset with that one. And things like that. And so you fume about it, and the next week, 2 or 3 hours, I get nothing done because I'm walking around the house saying, what am I going to do? I've hit all the buttons and nothing's happened. Wednesday, I tried to join the Bible study. No sound on my computer. I didn't touch it. I know Lois didn't do it. I blame her too much for things. I didn't need to blame her for that. No, she didn't. But all I could do was get off the computer. Rich wasn't saying anything I could hear. I couldn't talk to you guys either. And there was nothing to do. Sure enough, after an hour or two of saying, why did that happen? The computer says, you have downloads to load, you have upgrades on the computer. So I thought, okay, turn off the computer, let it upgrade. Everything's back to normal. Just was a couple hours later after Bible study. But then I had this, I went out before the Lord and said, Lord, you did it. I didn't know what to do, but you did it. So that's the way we have to be sometimes. And I think Luther had a good comment on this verse, verse 14. He says, enjoy the things that are present in such a way that you do not base your confidence on them, as though they were going to last forever. But reserve part of your heart for God, so that with it we can bear the day of adversity. And I think Luther was saying there what it means to consider what God has done. Consider simply isn't seeing what God has done. It's accepting it and saying, okay, Lord, you've allowed this. Now, what are you teaching me? What is in this for me? What do I have to do? Do I just sit and wait? Or should I do this? Or should I do that? And just maybe, if nothing else, the Lord wants you to sit down and talk to Him. I want you to spend some time talking to Him about your situation. Certainly we can praise God for our prosperity, but we have to trust Him in every adversity. And if the Lord can use the worst day of human history, the day of the crucifixion of our Lord, and He brought hope and brightness and happiness to the world forever through it, then can He not twist your crook to bring about good and promote His glory? Is your problem too big compared to Jesus' cross? That's what we're saying sometimes when we say, no, I don't want this. We need to live what we believe, that God works all things for our good. You know, people have a saying, put your money where your mouth is. We as Presbyterians and Calvinists and Reformed Christians need to do that more. Okay, Lord, this has happened. It's not pleasant. And I trust you. I know you love me. I know this is not you're punishing me at all, but instead you're teaching me. We need to be good Calvinists. Now, secondly, to overcome the crooks in our lot, we must live in the fear of God. What the preacher says next here has caused many scholars to agonize over his words. He writes, in this meaningless life of mine, I have seen both of these, a righteous man perishing in his righteousness, and a wicked man living long in his wickedness. In his observation, Solomon is confused by God's sovereign decree regarding the righteous and the wicked. Instead of rewarding the righteous with long life and blessings, my sister-in-law dies at 60. Not realizing some of the things she wanted in her life. That was the hard thing to watch her week after week for the last couple of months. Yet, that was the way of God. That was what He did. And she is enjoying life to the full. And everything that God has for us who love Him now. But we often think, oh, they died so young. Oh, they died so tragically and so forth. Because they were right and they were righteous people. And so we can't understand what God does. I knew a girl years ago when I was in seminary, biblical. I was helping at a Church of the Open Door. One of my friends, Juan Sack, was the youth leader at Church of the Open Door. And he needed help of the three groups. He had junior high, senior high, and college age. So I got the senior high group. And in the college and career age group, a guy and a girl married. They were married for a week. He was a mechanic. He was working on his car, and the car fell off the jack and crushed him. They were married for a week. And I know what the youth group and all went through was, why, Lord? Why 1 week? And she's a widow. I still don't have the answers to that. But that's the way it went. I also used to go to church at Calvary Church in Sonderton years ago. It was a different church. I'll say about it. But as I was attending that church, there was a teenage couple. I think he was about 19 and she was about 17. High school sweethearts. And they were engaged to be married when she graduated. But she got cancer. And what the family decided was, well, she wasn't working or going to school, so they performed a wedding, had a wedding, and she lived about 2 months after that was gone. But at least they had some time together in marriage. And I often thought, you know, she missed all the joys being a mother and enjoying marriage. That's the way it was. She was only 17. So we grieve because people's lives are taken far too young and far too soon. And a preacher has just said to us, who can straighten what God has made crooked? These injustices we wish God would straighten out. But knowing we can't, what can we do? How can we live in the light of these matters? What does a family, or extended family, or friends, or people, as I just
illustrate. What did they do?
Well, the preacher has some sage advice for us. He says, do not be over-righteous, neither be over-wise. Why destroy yourself? Do not be over-wicked, and do not be a fool. Why die before your time? It is good to grasp the one and not let go of the other. The man who fears God will avoid all extremes. Now, we can look at this, and this is very intriguing about the book of Ecclesiastes. You read something that Solomon writes, and you say, what is he saying? He seems to be saying the opposite of what we should be doing. And here he's saying, you know, don't be overly righteous, and don't be overly wicked, or actually he says, says it in a different way, but it comes out looking like, oh, you know, it doesn't matter if you sin. You know, go ahead. And don't be very holy. That's not what he's saying here. We are being urged to live a life not striving to be overly righteous or overly wicked, but the preacher's warning us that if anyone, whether righteous or unrighteous, can die young, which is very true, then do not think that somehow obtaining ultra-righteousness is going to guarantee you long life. Just to say, you know, I feel a rich young ruler. Oh, I've done all these things, you know. So God needs to reward me. I shall live to be 100. You know, or maybe 200. Like, you know, maybe like the patriarchs. Solomon said, he's not against righteousness or godly thought or speech or actions, but he is against attempting to tie God's hands or open God's hands by our behavior. By striving to be godly in your own strength, coming on a perfect righteousness of your own making, you cannot expect to prolong your life. But it'll only lead to your destruction, which is why, as he said, because only by Christ's righteousness do we have a guarantee of eternal life. It's this truth that Solomon wants us to grasp. No matter how righteous we become, we can never force God to prolong our lives due to our righteousness. Perfect righteousness is beyond our capability. There's no prolonging your life by working hard at living rightly. And then goes on to say something here in the negative, doesn't he? The other side of the coin. We must not think the preacher is advocating wickedness in any amount. He's not saying, as some would like him to say, oh, it's okay, you can live a little, just do whatever you want, no problem. That's not what he's saying. Literally, the Hebrew has, do not be very wicked. And what he is saying is that we must not choose to be wicked, not choose to sin deliberately. His advice is that we do not strive in any manner to live as we should not live. We live lives of faith in Christ and trust in His sovereignty. So having warned us against what will destroy us or be foolish, the preacher then comes to the best conclusion. It is good to grasp the one and not let go of the other. The man who fears God will avoid all extremes. A short way of describing this by what the preacher is saying is, the right way to live is to fear God. We don't do that when we correct God, or when we tell God we don't like what you're doing. That's not fearing God. It's not saying, by the way, that fear isn't saying you're afraid of what God's going to do to you. It's being reverent. I imagine there are times when you say to our parents as children, I don't like that. No, I won't do that. Well, we do that as Christians to our Heavenly Father, too. We should do that. We should live in godly fear and reverence of our Lord. At the end of his sermon on Ecclesiastes 7, in his commentary on the book of Ecclesiastes, Philip Brighton, who used to be the pastor of 10th Presbyterian Church, has a section in his sermon called The Shepherd's Crook. This is what he says in that portion. Whenever we are having trouble believing that God knows what he's doing, the first thing we should do is consider the work of our Savior. Remember that our good shepherd once had a crook in his lot, a crook that came in the shape of a cross. As Jesus considered the work of God, he could see that the only way to make atonement for his people's sin was to die in their place. So Jesus suffered the crooked cross that was his God-given lot to bear. And he trusted his Father, waiting for him to straighten things out when the time was right, when raising him up on the third day. And then Reichen makes this most important point. If God could straighten out something as crooked as the cross, then surely he can be trusted to do something with a crook in our lot. People of God, when you consider what God has done in his Son, and then all that he's doing right now in the lives of his people, all that we really can do and should do is to remember his love for us is so great that the crook of the cross, and that through the crook of the cross, and we should remember to trust our Heavenly Father to straighten out everything good in our lives, just as he straightened out for the Lord Jesus. Amen. This time we'll take our tithes and offerings.
Oh,
Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and give you support from Zion. Amen.